Okay. Thank you everyone for coming. There is some treats, but I guess we'll have to wait till afterwards, since we don't want a cafeteria style speech. So it's there, it won't go anywhere. So afterwards, make yourself at home. As you know, I am giving this this speech, Le'ilu Nishmat, my grandfather, David Ben Mordechai Kadosh. Tonight is his Shloshim. Many of you know who my grandfather was, and I think that's just a testament that you came out here tonight. He would certainly appreciate it. He made an effort to come to as many shiurim as he was physically capable of doing. Tonight in Montreal, there's well over 250 people at a seuda in his memory. So I felt I'll give a chance here in Toronto, where many of his children live, to speak about something, a topic that was very important to him. The topic of Tehillim. Anyone that knows my grandfather, knew him, met him, will attest that Tehillim was something that was always in his hand. The last 2 decades of his life, roughly, he would recite the entire book of Tehillim daily, sometimes more than once. There was a story that was sent throughout to my cousins by email after he passed away. One of my cousins sent a story that one Shavuot they went up to him, and as if to say proud, my cousin, his wife, and their son, they said that they combined to read the entire book of Tehillim. I think it was for his refuah, it was 7-8 years ago. And he basically nodded and he said, "That's very nice. Well, you read it once amongst you three, I read it twice myself." And it was 150 times 2, Leminyan Kapir. Kapir is forgiveness. Kapara is like we're connected to the Shuvah. So 150 chapters of Tehillim times 2 is Kapir. And that was his message. As if to say, "That's very nice what you did, but I doubled you." This was something that was fluent among him every day. That and Chok Le'Israel, maybe that another time we'll talk about Chok Le'Israel. So I figured, what a better topic to speak about than Tehillim, and I titled it, "Why Everyone Should Be Reading Tehillim." Every single person, man, woman, and even children. Tehillim, and we'll talk about it, we'll see the significance. I'll give you some segulot as to how it helps a person. And I think what I want to do at the end, given the situation that happened this morning in Eretz Yisrael, a horrific tragedy, where many, many batei kenesiyot are getting together to recite Tehillim, I thought we will switch it a little bit. And instead of reciting a Tehillim, we will learn one Tehillim. And a little, not so much in depth, but we will talk about every pasuk, and we'll analyze it, as that will also bring zechut to the neshamot, the korbanot that perished today in today's terrible tragedy, and also Bezrat Hashem will provide refuah for those that unfortunately are in need of our tefillot. So Tehillim is probably the most read book in the entire Tanakh. It's a book that many of us read daily. If you attend any tefillah during the day or during the week, you are reciting Tehillim. In Shachrit, you're reciting it during Pesukei Dezimra as a form of praise. Mincha, Ashrei Yosef Evetecha, Lamnatzeach El Hagitit. And every day during a tefillah, we're reading Tehillim. And if it's not during Tefillah, many people just sit idly and just recite Tehillim. Some do it, some finish it weekly, some finish it monthly. Some do it on their own pace. We also know that when someone passes away, here in our custom, in the Moroccan custom, is to recite the siman, which is the letters that form the person's name in chapter 119, where David HaMelech divides each letter into 8 pesukim, that we take the letter that spell out the person's name, as Le'ilu Nishmat. It has a certain magic, a certain power that no other book has. Tehillim is often read to heal other people. When other people need healing, refuah, we resort to Tehillim, which we'll talk about later on. The third Lubavitcher Rebbe was once quoted in saying that if people knew the power of Tehillim, we would never want to stop reading it. That's what he said. We would never want to stop reading it. Jews have read it during crisis. They have read it during times of need. And it's brought down in many Sefarim that when we recite Tehillim, it's as if David HaMelech himself is reciting it with us. And because he wrote about every possible situation or crisis that can come upon a person's life. We'll talk a little bit more in depth about David HaMelech soon. But when we come upon that chapter, it helps. When he talks about running away from enemies, then we find that chapter and we go. When he's talking about his physical well-being, we find that chapter and we read it. And again, given the events that happened this morning, I don't know how many Jews were not reciting some sort of Tehillim this morning. I know myself, in my classroom, with all my classes, I took a few moments to recite a few chapters of Tehillim. So we've seen also many stories, critical moments, where thousands of Jews were saved. There was a story in the 17th century with the Cossacks. The Cossacks were a group of Russian attackers that would attack Jewish villages in parts of Russia and other cities in Europe. And there was a story once that a certain city was spared from the Cossacks, and they didn't destroy them. So what happened was that after the city was spared, the tzaddik of the city died and came to someone in a dream and said, "You've been spared until now, but I'm telling you right now, you got to leave. Everyone's got to leave the city." So the person who was sleeping told the rabbi in the dream, "How do you know?" He said, "I'll tell you, because every day during the war, while the Cossacks were around destroying everybody else, I was praying Tehillim, and I was reading the book every day. And I knew that as long as I read it, nothing was going to happen to our city, because I knew that David HaMelech would go to HaKadosh Baruch Hu himself and beseech for us to protect it." So that was the protection. So he told him, advise everyone to leave. And it's many people that listened to the advice left and were spared from harm, and the others were perished, the ones that chose not to listen. So Tehillim is essentially a weapon. It's almost like it's like insurance for us. We read it, we believe in it. In times of danger, we open the book. Again, the most used book in our library. It can ward off many spiritual energies, and even though this was written so many years ago. There's a very famous Yalkut in Tehillim that says the following. Hitpalel David. David HaMelech prayed to Hashem and said the following to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Kol ha'osek batehilim, after getting approval from Hashem. Kol ha'osek batehilim, anybody that reads or learns Tehillim, sheyehe chashuv keilu osek banegaim uva'ahalot, is as if he gets credit for learning negaim and ahalot. Negaim and ahalot are two books of Mishnah. Mishnah is divided into six books, Shisha Sidre Mishnah. One of the things we say, Echad Miodea, Shisha Sidre Mishnah, right? So six Shisha Sidre Mishnah. Two of them are called Negaim and Aholot. So not only do you get credit for reading Tehillim, but says David HaMelech, you're going to get credit for reading Mishnayot, for learning Mishnayot. Not only are you going to get credit for reading Mishnayot, but Negaim and Aholot are the most difficult Mishnayot in the entire Torah. We're not talking about laws of Rosh Hashanah, Sukkah, which are a little bit more simple. No, Negaim and Aholot, which deal with very, very difficult concepts. You would get credit for studying them. Talmud Torah keneged kulam. It's the best reward you can get. So Chachamim asked, why did David HaMelech do this? It wasn't enough just to get reward for reading the Tehillim, but now he wanted to add an additional form of reward. So the answer that I heard was that every spare moment that we have, Jews, we have a responsibility and obligation to study Torah. The first chapter of Tehillim actually says, "Uv Torato yegeh yomam v'layla," that the Torah must be with us day and night. We don't always have that opportunity to sit down and study Torah. David HaMelech was the perfect example of that person who didn't always have that opportunity to study Torah. He was always on the run. For the beginning of his life, he was running away from Saul. Then he was running away from his enemies. He even ran away from his own son, Avshalom. So he was constantly on the run, constantly being chased. And the 150 chapters of Tehillim is another episode in David HaMelech's life. He found himself in fields, he found himself in caves. How many times we talk about it in our Tehillim, where David's praying in caves. He couldn't always learn. He couldn't have the chance. So David HaMelech is asking HaKadosh Baruch Hu, please, we want to do the mitzvah. We want to learn. We want to do everything we can, but it's impossible. Look at my life. I'm in a cave now. How do you expect me to sit down and learn Daf Yomi in a cave? It's impossible. So what am I supposed to do? So he says, give me credit that if I learn, that if I read the Tehillim, if I say the Tehillim, it's as if I learned the Mishnayot. And David HaMelech was talking about Jews nowadays, even nowadays. Unfortunately, not every Jew has the capability to study the depths of much of the Torah that we have. Not every Jew has the ability to learn a Mishnah or to learn a Gemara. But every Jew wishes they could attend the shiur. They're always inspired. Wow, that rabbi is amazing what he came up with. That's a tremendous chidush. But even though they couldn't come to terms or come to the time to study those in-depth parts of the Torah, everybody had a chance to read a Tehillim, because everybody was able to read Tehillim. And therefore, David HaMelech says, please, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, give them credit. Give these Jews credit. That even though they don't have the time, give them the reward. Because there's going to be times where they're going to be on an airplane. They're going to be on a train. They're going to be waiting for a bus. It's going to be minus 20 with the windshield. And they can't open up. They're stuck outside. But you know what? I'm stuck outside. I'll say one chapter of Tehillim that I know by heart. At least give them the credit, since they really want to. But why does David HaMelech choose that the reward that you're going to get are the two most difficult Mishnayot? Okay, you want to give reward? Why did he choose those specific two, Negaim and Aholot? So first of all, what is Negaim and what is Aholot? Negaim deals with blemishes. For example, someone who has leprosy, so all the laws of is he Tameh, is he Tahor, how long does it take, Mikra, all that stuff, that's Negaim. Aholot deals, literally, Aholot means tents, which are a dead person, Tumah and Tahara. If, God forbid, there was someone that passed away in this building, so we would have to know who is Tameh, who is Tahor, what constitutes a separation, how high the roofs have to be to constitute a separation, and all bunch of very difficult laws. There's another rule. The rule is that if I study something that is not applicable today, it's as if I fulfilled that mitzvah. So the perfect example we can give is that every morning, for 15 minutes, at the beginning of Shachrit, we read what we call Korbanot, the laws of sacrifices. And we read a whole bunch of Mishnayot. Nowadays, we don't have sacrifices. We don't have a Beit HaMikdash. We don't have where to offer these sacrifices. We don't have a Mizbeach. Nevertheless, we read it. And the Chachamim tell us, Unshalema Parim Sefatenu, that we should pay with our lips for these bulls, meaning we should be offering a bull. We should be offering a sheep or a cow or a chicken or whatever it is as a korban. We can't. So at least we do with our lips. We do with our mouth. So says the Chachamim, let the person who reads Tehillim be saved from the Negaim and Aholot. He should be saved from the situation where he will be afflicted by the leprosy, where he'll be afflicted by pain. He will be saved from the calamities and the personal tragedies. Why? Because he learned it. So this is what, if David HaMelech says, the chances are that a guy is going to learn Negaim and Ha'olot, almost impossible. But so if I make that the reward you're going to get for reading Tehillim is Negaim and Ha'olot, I'm going to be protected from it. Because that's the schar that I'm going to get for reading those two things. So Tehillim is considered like I learned those two things, and we ward off any spiritual power that can contaminate us, can make us ill with calamities or personal tragedies, and so on and so forth. One more explanation, says the Meshech Chochmah, on why David HaMelech chose these two books of Mishnayot as a reward for someone who reads Tehillim. And he says, the law of Negaim is as follows. A guy comes with what he thinks is to be leprosy. So he comes up, the Torah says you have to go to the Kohen. The Kohen looks at it, if he deems it Tameh, he declares him Tameh, and the guy needs to go outside of the camp for 7 days, stays there, and then he brings a korban, and then he's allowed back in. What happens if the Kohen has no idea what he's doing? Kohen Ama Aris. Well, we have no idea what he's doing. So a guy comes, and he shows him a spot on his arm, or his body, his house, whatever it is. He says, well, what's my status? He's got no clue. Kohen Ama Aris. So, says the Gemara, you know what he does? He calls the Tamid Chacham. And the Tamid Chacham looks at it, who knows the laws, and he whispers in the ear of the Kohen, either Tameh or Tahor. And then the Kohen will proclaim out loud, Tameh or Tahor. So even though he had no idea what he was talking about, he's able to rely on the words of the Tamid Chacham to declare this person Tameh or Tahor. So says the Meshech Chochmah, I want my Tehillim to be like the Negaim and the Aholot, who become the Negaim, who becomes Tameh by a Kohen who has no idea what he's doing. Meaning, even if a person has no idea what he's saying, by Tehillim, it counts. And it's one of the few Svarim that we have that you don't need to understand anything what is written in order to have full effect. And you will have total full effect by reading the Tehillim. Even if they're Amaretz, even if the person is so far off the path of Judaism, he reads the Tehillim, it finds its place in Shamayim. And that's why we don't call Tehillim Talmud Tehillim. But when we learn Torah, we call it Talmud Torah, the concept of learning Torah. By Tehillim, we call it Amirat Tehillim or Keriat Tehillim. Just saying it, just reading it. It's great to learn it if you can, but just reading it is perfectly fine. It's brought down that the 20 years that Yaakov Avinu was in the house of Lavan, 20 years, we're going to get to it soon in the Parashat Shavua, he was reading the Tehillim. He was reading the Tehillim to protect himself from the evil of Lavan. The entire time that Yosef HaTzadik was in Egypt, he was reading the Tehillim. There's a story in Masechet Avodah Zarah. I read this in the Me'am Noiz. And the story goes of Levi and Rabbi Shimon, who were learning Chumash. And they finished learning their Chumash. So they were deciding, what am I going to learn next? What are we going to learn next? We finished Chumash. We all get to the level, we all finish learning Chumash. What are we going to learn next? So Levi said, bring Mishle. Let's learn Mishle. And Rabbi Shimon said, no, let's bring Tehillim. So they arguing back and forth. Rabbi Shimon won, and Rabbi Shimon managed to convince Levi to bring Tehillim. So they start learning the first chapter of Tehillim, and they get to the pasuk, "Petorat Hashem chetzo uftorato yege yomam balayla." So Rabbi Yehuda Nasi was in front of them. He was the rabbi, and he gets his pasuk, "Petorat Hashem chetzo." That's the Torah of Hashem is his desire. And he says, "En Adam lomed Torah ela mimakom shelibo havetz." Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi said that a person should not learn Torah unless his heart desires as to what he wants to learn that. If he doesn't want to learn that, then he shouldn't learn that particular subject. The story ends that Levi tells Rabbi Yehuda Hanasi, "Thank you very much, Rabbi. I'm out of here." And he walked out of the shul because he goes, "I didn't want to learn that Tehillim in the first place. I wanted to learn Mishle." So the Marsha asks, why did Shimon force Levi to take Tehillim? What was wrong with Mishle? Why Davka was he so insistent on taking Mishle? So he brings one answer that Tehillim comes before Mishle in the order of the Ketuvim. Tehillim comes first. But it says to Maharsha that there's a big difference between Tehillim and Mishle as to what they teach you. Mishle is wisdom. It's wisdom from Shlomo HaMelech. Tehillim is Yirat Shamayim. Tehillim brings you fear of heaven. If you want both wisdom and Yirat Shamayim, you need to do Yirat Shamayim first. You need to do the Tehillim first. As it says in Perkei Avot, Kol sheyirat chet'o kodemet lechokhmato, chokhmato mitkayemet. So if anyone who puts their fear of God, their fear of sin, prior to their chokhmah, then the chokhmah is going to stand. You need to make that your focus, your yirat chet'o, your yirat shamayim. Everybody aims to be smart in this world. I don't think there's anyone in this world that doesn't want to be smart. That's the main goal. People want to do everything. People want to see everything. You know, what do? They just landed a rocket on a comet, for crying out loud. Like, it took 10 years of 6 billion kilometers to get the timing. You think about it, it's unbelievable. In the end of the day, I don't know what they gained from it, but it was still a tremendous accomplishment, because to them, they feel, look what I accomplished. I accomplished wisdom. So, says for Kevod, you want to acquire wisdom? No problem. You got to put your Yirat Shamayim, you got to put your fear of heaven first. And that comes through Tehillim. I want to, with your permission, I want to take this shiur a little bit deeper. In Parashat Bereshit, there's a midrash that says on the pasuk, Zeh Sefer Toldot HaAdam. This is the book of the generations of Adam. So the Yalkut Shimoni says that HaKadosh Baruch Hu showed Adam a book. And in that book, he showed him all the generations that were going to be born from him to the end of time. And he showed him that there was a certain individual named David. And this David was only going to live for 3 hours. 3 hours. So Adam HaRishon said, may 70 years of my life go to this soul. This beautiful one, I present him with Malchut and Zmirot, which is sovereignty and songs. For the 70 years of his life, he should sing before you. This is what's written in the Yalkut Shimon. Adam HaRishon lived 930 years. He was supposed to live 1,000 years. And he gave 70 years of his life to David HaMelech because he saw that he was only going to live for 3 hours. We're going to get to this story in a little bit more depth very shortly. But let's understand what the purpose of man is. Man is really the greatest wonder of the world. We are a miniature world. We're a world that's composed of every element that's found in creation and in the universe. What is the purpose of this universe? Hashamayim mesaperim kevodet u'maaseh yadav magid harakia. The heavens declare the glory of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, and the sky talks about its work, its handiwork. Meaning the purpose of the universe is to praise HaKadosh Baruch Hu. There is something known as Perek Shira. Anyone here heard of Perek Shira? Perek Shira is a chapter or a group of songs which every creature performs its tasks. Every creature performs its task without deviation. So it goes. So okay, the frog, this is what it says, and it performs it. And by performing that task, then it's contributing to praising HaKadosh Baruch Hu, since that's what it was the purpose, why HaKadosh Baruch Hu created it. But you have this whole bunch of sounds. The frog is doing this, the zebra is doing this, the elephant's doing this, the bird is chirping this way. You have a whole bunch of sounds. But any group of sounds needs, so to speak, what we call nowadays a conductor to put it all into motion and to make it sound good. HaKadosh Baruch Hu made Adam HaRishon this conductor, man. So man's job on this world, our power, our dominion over every creature, is not something that is a privilege, it's an obligation. All the people that give animals equal rights, they're out to lunch. Animals don't have equal rights as humans. Humans have more power over animals. Which talents did Adam HaRishon need to use to accomplish this feat, to put everything in order? Malchut, sovereignty, and Zmirot. That's what he said. That's what he told Hashem. I want to give 70 years of my life with Malchut and Zmirot, sovereignty and song, to this person, David HaMelech. So now we're really going to get a little bit deep. Adam HaRishon was created on the sixth day of creation, Erev Shabbat. That day consisted of 12 hours. Every day, actually, in the Jewish calendar consists of 12 hours of daytime. We just have shorter days and longer days, but it's considered 12 hours. In the ninth hour of the day, 3 hours before Shabbat, HaKadosh Baruch Hu calls Adam and says, Adam, come, we need to talk. And he says, Adam, we have some rules and regulations. It's very simple. You can do anything you want, except one thing. One thing. You can't eat from that tree. He said that in the ninth hour. His role as this conductor, his role as this caretaker, was meant only to last for 3 hours. If Adam HaRishon would have reached hour number 12, it would have been done. He would have ushered in Shabbat to Gan Eden, and that would have been the end. There would have been no sin. There would have been no evil. The world as we know would have been totally different. However, he failed. And instead of ushering the Shabbat into Gan Eden, he got kicked out of Gan Eden because he ate from the tree. Not only did he fall, he dragged the entire universe with him. And he devoted the rest of his life to teshuvah for this sin. In fact, we are all here on this world being metaken, fixing this one sin of Adam HaRishon. So what did he do? He searched the pages of history. HaKadosh Baruch Hu shows him this entire book of every generation, of every person. And he says, which is going to be the soul that's going to bring back perfection? Who's going to lead the world back to perfection? And he discovered David HaMelech, a person who was only going to live for 3 hours, the same 3 hours that he messed up on. This man, David HaMelech, and what did he bless him with? Malchut and Zmirot. He blessed him with sovereignty, with kingship, and he blessed him with song, with praise. And he told HaKadosh Baruch Hu, give 70 years of my life, give him 70 years to fulfill it. Give 70 years for him to fix what I did wrong. So you would think, okay, we're good. David HaMelech is going to fix Adam HaRishon's sin. Everything is going to go as planned. Unfortunately, it didn't come so easy to David HaMelech. The Mesilat Yesharim, one of the most incredible Musar works of all time, says that HaKadosh Baruch Hu places man constantly in battle. And the battles can be good battles or bad battles, but each battle is a test. Wealth is a test, poverty is a test, suffering, peace, everything is a test. The Chovot Levavot gives an example of a guy who comes back from a battlefield. And the rabbi greets him, says, welcome back. You thought you just had a war, now wait till the war you're about to experience. This war is called life, he tells him. Because that is our war, a lifelong battle with the Yetzer Hara. He composed, David HaMelech composed Tehillim while he was struggling constantly with the Yetzer Hara. He composed Tehillim while he was in the midst of the worst turbulence you can imagine. And he talks about his times of evil and his times of good and how good and evil rage within him at all times. People mistaken Tehillim for poetry. Tehillim is not poetry. Tehillim is usually is a cry. It's a plea. It's a plea for perfection, because that's what Adam HaRishon wanted from the onset. There's an amazing story brought down in Masechet Sanhedrin. The story is of Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah. For those that don't know, these three individuals were, them three along with Daniel, became prime servants of Nebuchadnezzar, the evil king of Babel. And to make a long story short, Nebuchadnezzar wanted them to bow down to a tzelem, to himself, an image of himself, as an Avodah Zarah, and they refused. These three, Daniel wasn't there, but these three, Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah, refused. And he had them thrown into a furnace. This furnace was so hot that when his own non-Jewish servants opened the furnace, they melted. That's how they died. That's how hot this furnace was. To make a long story short again, Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah were not killed by this furnace. Similar like Abraham Avinu was not killed by Melech Nimrod, these three people were not. They were saved by the angel Gabriel. Says the Gemara in Sanhedrin that Nebuchadnezzar was so impressed with what he just witnessed, he couldn't believe it, that he prepared to write and recite praise of Hashem, says the Gemara, that would have surpassed Tehillim, that would have put Tehillim to shame. That's how impressed he was. He had it ready. Came an angel, struck him on the mouth, and he didn't recite it. This is the Gemara. So a couple questions. Number one, how could this be that this evil Yimach Shemo tyrant, who was the prime sole person responsible for the destruction of the first Beit HaMikdash, this guy is going to outdo David HaMelech and Tehillim? What's the Gemara actually saying over here? And if he could, then let him do it. Why send an angel to punch him in the mouth and stop him? So the Kutzker Rebbe answers the following. And he says, Inachinami, yes, it's very, very possible that you will have many writers who are good with the pen. There are amazing poets out there that have just a mind for poetry and a mind for writing, who boast about their skills. But, says the Kutzker Rebbe, it's not the style, the literary style, that makes Tehillim what it is. It's not what he said, but when he said it. The Chidush of Tehillim is the time of David HaMelech's life when he wrote it. One can become ecstatic, one can write Megillot, one can come up with the most amazing words when he's watching miracles occur. But it's only the rare individual who can do something when he falls. Only a rare individual like David HaMelech, who could be crushed, who could be beaten, who could be rebelled by his own son in front of him, son wanting to kill him, that can write, quote-unquote, poetry like this. So comes the Malach and says, God says to the Malach, go to Nebuchadnezzar and tell him the following. You want to write sacred music? You want to find all this poetry and come up with all these words? Let's see how you do after the blow. So comes the Malach and he strikes him on the mouth. He said, now you're hurt. Now life isn't so good. Let's see what you can come up with now. And Nebuchadnezzar couldn't write anything. Because it's all good when you're witnessing the most incredible thing, to take a pen and everything just flows. But when things are hard, it's not easy. In all of Tanakh, we find nobody, as much as David HaMelech, who suffered so much. No one was misunderstood as much as David HaMelech. No one had so many enemies. You can argue that Iyov had a lot of suffering, but his lasted only a short while. David was mamash from the moment he became king. From the moment he was anointed as king, he experienced jealousy from all sides, whether it was from Shaul, and then it was the enemies. He had to deal with so many things. So David's life was one misfortune after another. What makes Tehillim beautiful is that most of the time, It's read for the well-being of somebody else, most of the time. Not many people that read it for their own. But often when we get calls, this person's sick, this person needs to get married, this person's having difficulty getting pregnant, we open the book and we read it for somebody else. When we pray for somebody else, we make ourselves more aware of our brothers and our sisters. It brings Ahavat Yisrael, and it gets rid of Sinah, Kin'ah, and Tachrut. It gets rid of jealousy and hatred. There was a story of Rav Nassim Tzvi Finkel, Zichrono Livracha, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, where he was in a dentist office, and he was sitting there waiting. And in the room behind him, he was hearing the moaning of a man who was getting his teeth pulled out. All of a sudden, the rabbi started praying and crying uncontrollably. And the guy said, what's going on? Everything okay? We didn't even give you any nothing, no anesthesia, nothing, no freezing. He goes, I can't take the suffering of the guy behind me. So when there's a certain power when we feel the need to pray for other people. Tehillim is something that we should really get into the habit every day, whether it's one chapter a day, again, or it's finishing every month, or like I said, or every week. It's addicting. And even if it doesn't work, and I know a lot of people think this, the person's situation is so dire that you say to yourself, man, is this even going to help? Is this even going to help? Besides, for a different time that we should always pray, and even if the person is on his last straw in life, you never give up hope. Again, that's a speech for a different time. But never think for one moment that even if the person you were praying for, even if he doesn't survive, even if he passes on, even if the person you were praying for to have children couldn't have the children, never think for one moment that your prayers are for naught, that your prayers were not seen by Shammayim. Because after 120 years, you're going to have, every person is going to have the kategor and the sanegor. He's going to have the prosecutor and the defendant up there with him in Shammayim. And while the prosecutor is going to give every reason why this person shouldn't merit a share in the world to come, here's going to come the defendant and he's going to say, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, look at all the people that prayed tehillim for this person. That doesn't count. That doesn't count, all those tefillot. The fact that they did it for him, it's enough of a reason. So even if it ends, God forbid, in tragedy, it's only helping the person. I want to take the next few minutes just to give you a little taste of things that I found doing some research on what Tehillim can accomplish, certain segulot. So the word Tehillim comes from the word tahel, or, which means flash forth a light. Because Tehillim, it's only light, and Tehillim has the power to remove the mekatregim, the evil spirits that are out there to get us, and provides rachamim through the light. Says the Tehillah le David, the one who recites Tehillim every day is guaranteed Olam Haba. Every day. Says the Shira Pardes Menachem, when a person recites Tehillim, the Geula Shelema is brought closer. The Baba Sali was once quoted by Rav Elfasi that every Jew is required to complete Sefer Tehillim once a month. This is from the words of the Baba Sali. And that there are certain powers and significance from Tehillim, because as I mentioned, David HaMelech is the person saying it himself. So, quoted by Rav Elfasi. David HaMelech, Tehillim includes the entire Torah within it. That's why, by the way, if you read the Yehi Ratzon at the end, he will say, Sishyamti Sefer Rishon Shetehillim, Keneged Sefer Bereshit. The second book, Keneged Shemot, Zer Vayikra. Meaning, because each book corresponds to another book in the Torah. And if you study Tehillim extremely deeply, you will find that every single mitzvah, both Deoraita and Rabbanan, even the seven mitzvot from the rabbis, are hinted to in the Torah. One who wants to do Teshuvah should regularly recite Tehillim. Many people find it difficult to do Teshuvah. Hard to admit your sin. It's a lot of big process. So Chachamim tell us, reciting Tehillim brings us to do Teshuvah. Why? Because there are 50 gates of Teshuvah, and whatever these gates are, but we don't know which one to use to reach the final Teshuvah. So, by reciting Tehillim, we are going to find the right key to the right gate to do Teshuvah. How do I know this? Says this is a Likutei Maharan, this is from Breslov. Ve'ele shemot b'nei Yisrael habayim Yisraima et Yaakov ishu beto ba'u. The last letters of that pasuk spell Tehillim and Teshuvah. Tehillim and Teshuvah. What follows that pasuk? The names of Yaakov's 12 sons. Reuven, Shimon, Levi, Yehuda. And the names of the 12 sons have 49 letters corresponding to the 49 gates of Teshuvah that will take you to gate number 50. So you see, Tehillim, Teshuvah, and first pasuk through Am Yisrael reciting Tehillim. If one learns Tehillim with Kavanah, it's a pidyon. It'll bring redemption. That's why David HaMelech wrote 150 chapters of Tehillim. The gematria of pidyon is 150. So through the studying of Tehillim with Kavanah, we can redeem ourselves through all types of misfortune. By reciting Tehillim, we fulfill all the mitzvot of the Torah. Says the first letters of the words "Tuku leraglecha yisa midaberotecha" in Parashat Zot HaBeracha spell out the word Tehillim. There are many ways, by the way. I didn't get into this on the name of Tehillim. It's not everyone calls it Tehillim. In the Gashi, the Gemara, many times refers to Tehillim as just Tehillim. That's how it calls it. So "Tuku leraglecha yisa midaberotecha," the word Tehillim. Which is the pasuk that follows that? Torah tzivalanu Moshe. Morasha Keilat Yaakov. So as if you fulfill the entire Torah. You look at the pasuk, Veikatem Leavi et Kol Kevodi Bemitzrayim. The last letters of that pasuk also spell the word Tehillim. Whoever recites Tehillim daily, says Rabbeinu Ephraim, is Keilu, he's Yosef, Tachat Kisea Kavod. Parnasa, it's a segula for Parnasa. Because you have the pasuk Limtar Hashamayim Tishte Mayim, again the first letters that talk about Limtar Hashamayim, rain from the heavens that brings Parnassah, also spells out Tehillim. And for this, there's lots. There's for women in labor, which we're going to study now. It's very good to read pasuk of Perikaf Yancha Hashem Beyom Sarah, which I'm going to take a few minutes talking about. For a woman suffering in childbirth, with my wife's permission, I remember with my last child that her labor was not an easy one, and I remember, actually I was sleeping, then I woke up and I noticed a whole commotion in the room. No, I was there for this one, so I was there for all of them. Sometimes too close a little bit, but. And I remember, okay, now is a good time, and I had this whole tefillah, and most of the tefillah was reciting Perek Kaf Yancha Hashem Beyom Sarah, saying it a few times. There's 9 pesukim corresponding to the 9 months of labor, okay, and there are 70 words in the chapter corresponding to the 70 pains of childbirth. So I said it, and Baruch Hashem, after that, things just, I guess, for me, flew by. And it went smoothly. And I remember right afterwards, I went to Chacham Asayak, and I told him, I go, you know, I found this. It was from the Chida. He goes, of course. He goes, Asayak says, I did that for all my children, the same tefillah. So that's, and it comprised of mainly this pasuk of, this perek of Tehillim, perek of. And of course, someone that looks to get married, a shiduch. One of the major segulot is Kuf Chaf Aleph with Shira Maalot, Esai Enai Learim, Me'ayin Yavo Ezri. Basically, he says the Igra de Pirka. He says, why is this? Because, and this is what Yaakov Avinu said before he got married. He brings it down from somewhere, I guess. I trust him. And he says, Me'ayin Yavo Ezri, where is my help? Where's my helper going to come from? Me'ayin Yavo Ezri, we're referring to his wife. And the next pasuk says, Ezri Me'im Hashem. HaKadosh Baruch Hu brings the helper. He's the one who decides from the 40 days after the child is created inside the womb of the family. He already made the match. between the husband and the wife, who the person is going to get married. Okay, I want to take some time, as I mentioned in the beginning, for those who weren't here. Like I mentioned, there's a lot of Batei Knesiyot tonight that are doing a lot of Tehillim. Someone sent me a message and said, you know, it's not a coincidence that you're doing this tonight because, you know, Am Yisrael needs Tehillim and maybe we could recite some Tehillim. And I thought, let's do something different. Let's do take one Tehillim, one chapter, and we'll just talk a bit, we'll translate it and we'll talk about it. And we're going to get the same Zechut, I promise you, learning the chapter and reading it. So I chose this one, Chaf, which is Yancha Hashem B'Yom Tzara, which actually is a chosen chapter when Am Yisrael is suffering. It's one of the ones that is known, that we're asking HaKadosh Baruch Hu to answer us. So feel free if you want to take a Sidur, but most of you may know it by heart. If not, I'm going to read the Pesukim anyways. Forgive me for looking through here because I just wrote this up today, actually not long before I came here. So the Perek begins, Lamnatzeach Mizmor LeDavid, which is a conductor, a song, for the conductor, a song of David. Says the Malbim that this Perek of Tehillim was inspired by events that happened in Shmuel Bet, in the second book of the book of Samuel, where David HaMelech was in mortal danger, and he was almost killed by Yishbi, who was a Philistine giant. And miraculously, it was Avishai ben Seruya who sped from Yerushalayim on David's horse and saved the king at the last moment. So this is what he's talking about. He's giving you the prelude of which point in David HaMelech's life is he writing this. And he says, Yancha Hashem beYom Tzara. May Hashem accept your prayer on the day of distress. Meaning what? That Hashem listens to our tefillah immediately, on the day of distress. It's not, it doesn't wait a day, it doesn't wait 2 days. The problem is happening now. Now we're suffering. Now is when He's listening. When the lines of the enemy are in front of you, when they're on the battlefield, that's when He's going to answer you. Yesagevcha Hashem Eloi Yaakov. May the name of the God of Yaakov make you unbeatable. Why the God of Yaakov? Why not Elohe Abraham? Why not Elohe Yitzchak? So, Chachamim say that HaKadosh Baruch Hu promised to protect Yaakov in the house of Lavan. Because in the house of Lavan, he found himself in situations which he would never yet to deal. You know, it is living 20 years with one of the biggest Rasha'im to ever come step foot on this earth. They say that Lavan was the same Neshama as Bilam, or say the opposite. Bilam was the same Neshama as Lavan. That there was so much evil in him. More than Abraham and Yitzchak. Yaakov had to face much more than Abraham and Yitzchak. Plus, he was the father of all 12 tribes. So it would make sense that when we refer to the God of Israel, we speak as Elohei Yaakov. Yishlach ezrecha mikodesh umitzion yisadeka. May He dispatch your help, mikodesh, from the holy place, umitzion yisadeka, and support you from Tzion. Says the Malbim, there's a difference between the word ezer, which is Ezra, which means help, and Soed, Yisadeka. Ezer refers to the main cause of salvation that someone uses to help when he's in distress. And Lisod is talking about a secondary support. So David HaMelech is saying, I want my primary salvation, my Ezer, to come from Kodesh. I want it to be from a holy source. From HaKadosh Baruch Hu, not from unholy sources. I don't want myself to succeed because I needed a non-Jewish king to come join me as an ally to help win. That's not what I want my primary salvation to come from. The armies that are going to come and help me, Yisadeka, fine, they're going to come in Tzion. The armies that come from Tzion that are going to come and join me, that's secondary. But my main source of salvation has to be Mikodesh, from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Yizkor kol minchotecha ve'olatecha yeda shenesela. May He remember all your offerings and consider your burnt sacrifices generous. Says the Ibn Ezra, why should God help you? Because He's going to remember your offerings. He's going to remember all the times you offered stuff to Him. Says Rashi, you don't take this literally. HaKadosh Baruch Hu is not remembering your korbanot, your minchatot and olot. Rather, it's talking about your tefillot. It's your prayers. Again, unshalema parim sefatenu. It's our tefillot, which come in the form, which take place of the korbanot. That's what he's going to remember. Yiten lecha kilvavecha vechol atzatecha yemale. Which means, may he grant you your heart's desire and fulfill your every plan. Says the Malbim something incredible. When one is saved by a man, when a man saves a person, the person who is saving, the Savior, designs the rescue in any way he can come up with. He needs the bottom line. I need to save this guy. However I manage to find a way to save him, I'm going to save him. Even when it's not the most desirable way for the person being saved. So not so HaKadosh Baruch Hu. HaKadosh Baruch Hu brings the victory exactly according to the wishes of the people being saved. Every execution, every tactic, every strategy is going to be successful. Yiten lecha kidvavecha v'chol atzatecha yemaleh, and fulfill your every plan. Neranena bishuatecha u'shem Eloheinu nidgol yemaleh Adonai kol mishalotecha. That we may sing for joy at your victory and raise our banner in the name of God when he fulfills all your requests. So it says here, when one calls out for the assistance of another man, if I call somebody else to help me to fight my battles, at the end of the day, if I'm successful and I'm victorious, I cannot proudly say that I did it myself, because I showed weakness by calling someone else to help me. Not so the people that call out to Hashem. Niranena bishuatecha. We're going to be joyous. We're going to sing and praise for the fact that you saved us. Here, a person can declare victory that he did on his own, and it was his own personal achievement. Why? Because he had the smarts and he had the wisdom to call out to Hashem rather than rely on his own strength and on his allies. Niranena bishuatecha. Hashem Eloheinu nidgol. Right. We raise our banner. So here, an interesting thought, that in the desert, all the Shevatim had different flags and different banners, a different symbol and different colors. But here, in the future, this pasuk can also be referring to Biyat HaMashiach. In the future, all divisions are going to be banished, and there's going to be one banner that's going to be united under Hashem. Ata yadati ki oshia Hashem meshicho. Now I know that Hashem has made His Anointed One victorious. Meaning, now I know He still desires me as the Anointed One, because He made me victorious. This is the victory that I was referring to in the beginning. Ya'aneu mishemei kotzo bigvurot yeshaimino. He will answer him from his sacred heaven with the victories of his right arm. Because David HaMelech's wars, if you study them, it's like 500 versus 10,000. And they won. Literally, it was that much outnumbered. There's a victory which comes through natural channels of war. Those are victories that are done with the left hand. But here, it's bigvurot yesha yemino. It's with his right hand. Whenever there's an intervention that comes supernaturally, it's a total miracle, that salvation is attributed to the right hand. Ele vareche ve'ele basusim. Some win through chariots. And some, or not win, some use chariots, and some through horses. So says the Malbim, if you look, not the Malbim, sorry, the Midrash, in Az Yashir Moshe that we read every day, we say, Sus verochevo rama vayam, which means that HaKadosh Baruch Hu drowned, he threw into the water, Sus, the horse, verochevo, and the rider. What does the horse represent, and what does the rider represent? The horse represents the animalistic nation of Mitzrayim. It was the most immoral, animalistic country that existed. The rider refers to the Tsar, the angel, that guardian angel that every country has, who controls in heaven what goes on. So some attack us using the scheme of the rider, meaning they're going to rely on their angel to come and defeat us. And some are going to attack using horses, using the physical, the animal strength of the soldiers. But none of them put their faith in God. V'anachnu, b'shem Hashem Eloheinu naskir. We call out in the name of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, says Rabbeinu Bachya, amazing. If you look in the beracha that Yaakov Avinu gave to Yehuda in Parashat Vayechi, every single letter is found in of the Aleph Bet is found in the beracha except for one. Except for one, the letter Zayin. The letter Zayin is not found in that. What does Zayin mean? Weapons. Zayin in Hebrew means weapons. Yehuda is a tribe of royalty. It's a tribe of David HaMelech. The Torah wanted to emphasize, Yehuda, you're going to be the tribe of kings. You're going to be the tribe of sovereignty. Understand that the king does not depend on the military strength. You're not. The letter Zayin is not going to be found in your bracha. There's going to be no weapons. You're going to use weapons, but that's not what you're going to be dependent on. Because anachnu b'shem Hashem Elohim naskiv. Hema karu v'nafalu v'anachnu kamnu v'nitodad. They slumped and fell. We arose and we became invigorated. The Radak says, "We who originally fell before the enemy through our sins, we got up. We overwhelmed him when we mentions our Kadosh Baruch Hu's name. Hashem Adonai Hoshia Hamelech Ya'anenu b'yom korenu. Hashem save. The King will answer us on the day we call." The Midrash on this Tehillim sums up this Perek with a long list of quotations that demonstrate how Am Yisrael is only successful when they actually call out to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And that's why Am Yisrael is also nicknamed Tolaat Yaakov. What's Tolaat Yaakov? The worm of Yaakov. So just as the tiny worm can attack this mighty cedar tree, the strongest of all woods, the worm can bore holes using nothing more than its mouth, so too Am Yisrael is armed with the greatest weapon we can have, HaKol Kol Yaakov, which is the prayers of the mouth. And that essentially is the power of Tehillim. Again, I gave the shiur in memory of my grandfather, a person that Tefillah and Tehillim was priority number one. There was nothing more important to him than the recital of Tehillim, whether it is he did it every day. The commitment that he had to Tefillah, really, I learned it from him. I make an effort myself personally to be one of the first 10. Rabbi Azulai can tell you what it is, the importance of being one of the first 10 in Minyan. This was my grandfather. He had so much difficulty walking for most of his life. I can tell you that in the Bet Knesset that he prayed at, the first one I don't remember much, but the one where most of my life that I remembered, he had to walk up like 20 steps, 25 steps to go there. You know what a hassle it was with his walker and in the freezing cold, and every two steps he would stop and he would breathe, and then another two steps he would stop and he would breathe. And most people, they wouldn't think of it. Nowadays, you know, we're so far out of it. You got a little weather like this, a little cold, you know, and that's it. Forget about it. 7 minutes, I'm not even thinking about it. I'm going to stay at home and that's it. It wasn't even a question. He never thought of it. It never even crossed his mind not to come to the Beit Knesset. This was something that was important to him. This is something that was his life. This is besides the recital of the parasha weekly and his love for Zemirot. He lived up to David HaMelech in the best way that he could of Malchut and Zemirot. Malchut, he was so strong with the man. He made sure that everyone was perfect. He demanded perfection. He demanded perfection, which maybe we should do a little bit more of nowadays, of demanding perfection. This was his life. You know, and if there's a lot of things I feel that we can learn from this. Number one, obviously, the subject that we talked about. It's so easy to take a Tehillim now. It's so handy. You know, you have apps, you know, on your phone. You have on your website. You have daily Tehillim websites. You have speeches all over the place. Even if it's one perek a day or a few prakim a day, yeah, we have no idea the power that it can give us. And more so, if we can take that and expand that to our everyday tefillot, which are anyways composed of Tehillim for a large part. And if my grandfather can choose one thing to impart to the generation that succeeds him and the people that are going to live on who he was, is this importance of tefillah, this importance of understanding what Kedushat Beit HaKnesset, coming on time, understanding the importance of coming on time, because it's a chaval, the people that miss a good quarter or a third of the tefillah, they miss the tehillim part. They miss the Pesukei Dezimra. They come in, it's already said, oh, okay, I'm rushing just to say Shema and Amidah with the people. What happened to the Tehillim? What happened to Ashrei Yashrei Betecha? What happened to the Hallelujahs? What happened to all that part in the beginning? You know, it's not there. Okay, well, Shema is more important. I'm not going to argue. Shema is more important. But you have to understand, Shema and Amidah, how can you go and ask HaKadosh Baruch Hu for things in Shemona Esrei without praising Him first? We have to praise Him first. That praise comes through the form of Tehillim. Bezrat Hashem, this lesson, this lecture should be Leilui Nishmato. It should come, it should give him Aliyah in Shamayim. And for all those people that unfortunately today are suffering and the tragedy that happened today in Am Yisrael, those people that need refuah, they should receive that refuah. We should be spared from any future tragedies, any future horrific events like we experienced today. And I'm telling you that it's going to come through. It's going to come through if we all take a little bit more to read. We all know the power of Tehillim. I hope now we know the power of Tehillim. And I just want to re-say what that third Lubavitcher Rebbe said. If we only knew what the power of Tehillim was, we would never want to stop saying it. Amen. Ken Yiratzon. Rabbi Hananya. מלך השם מרצה קוס ברוחו זה גוי ישראל לפיכה חיבה להם את המצוות שנאמר אדוני חפץ סימן שיקו יגדיר תורה ויגדיר